Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be in this house. Lord, we just lift you up and we magnify and we glorify you that we get to come into this place, Lord, with these comforts such as air conditioning and electricity and so forth and so on. Lord, we thank you that we get to come into this place and to magnify Jesus, because that's why we're here. We're not here for a man. We're not here for a woman. We're not here for tradition or ritual. We are here for you, Lord. We are here to hear from you. And we acknowledge that it's Jesus that's the leader of this house. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask your Holy Spirit would lead us and guide us and direct us and remind us and counsel us in your word, that you might create in us the identity of who you want us to be, that we walk out of this building and we become your church to shine your glory for the world to see. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. We don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but rather as co-laborers in the body of Christ. And Lord, we know that you have strategically placed us here in this Inland Empire with the other churches of the area to reach this valley for you. And Lord, we thank you that you would bless them as you have blessed us. Bless local churches like Harvest and The Grove. Lord, we thank you for churches like Sandals and Water of Life and Ecclesia. Lord, we thank you for The Way and Emmanuel Baptist and Victory and Trinity. And Lord, all the multiple churches, the Calvary Chapels and all the denominational churches and all of our brothers and sisters today that are meeting and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. Speak to them as you have spoken to us and will speak to us today. And Lord, on this day, we ask that you would speak to your persecuted church. Lord, this is the day that the church sets aside to pray for the persecuted church. And Lord, we know that there are many around the world that are dying and being persecuted for the name of Jesus. And God, we ask that you would protect them. Lord, we ask that you would speak to them. Lord, we ask that you would deliver them and guide them and guard them. Lord, we thank you that they go before us and they set the example of a life dedicated to Jesus Christ. And Lord, those who have given their lives for the name of Jesus, we thank you for the legacy that they have left behind of a life of dedication. And God, we ask that you would set your hand upon the church all across the world that is persecuted for the name of Jesus. And Lord, we ask that you would be with them today. Be with us and speak to us today, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' mighty name. We all said, amen. Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles, go with me to Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11, chapter 11, verse number 17. Now, if you've got a Bible, get it out. We've got a lot of word. I'd love to have you, if you could, take notes, because it's a lot of stuff, great stuff. You need to get what we're going to talk about today. Maybe you've got a device. You know, I've kind of gotten that way, too. I love my Bible. I love the tactile feedback of pages. But every once in a while, I even have a device. So if you've got a device, take it out and thumb there or whatever it is, YouVersion or Bible Gateway or however it is you read the Word of God. But get it out. Open it up to the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse number 17. We're going to go line upon line, precept upon precept, and here we are after just finishing the Homeland series. We're going to start a whole new subject, looking back into the subject and the content of Abraham and his son Isaac. We're going to look at that in Hebrews 11, chapter verse number 17. The title this morning is this is a test. Do you guys remember analog TV? Does anybody remember analog TV? You remember when your TV was square, right? And if you wanted to mount it on the wall, you'd have to reinforce the entire wall to hold the weight of that behemoth. Do you remember back in the day, it always seemed like it happened right in the middle of your favorite broadcast on a Saturday afternoon during like a football game or whatever that great show was or whatever it was. There was those color bars came on and then the noise, and then the voice would come on. This is a test of the emergency broadcast system. And you'd have to go through the whole process and have to wait through all of that thing. It was a test to test out that system. And we're going to talk today about this test that we see. And in the book of Hebrews 11, chapter, verse number 17, it tells us that by faith, Abraham. See, the Bible tells us by faith, the context of Hebrews 11, chapter, is all about the working of faith. Bible tells us that it is without faith, it is impossible to please God. See, everything we do and everything that goes on is done and operated through the course of faith. And here the Bible gives us again the picture of Abraham by saying, by faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. And the Bible goes on and talks about that. And I want to give you a little bit of background about this story, and we can leave that verse up for just a moment. In Genesis, the 22nd chapter, you'll find this test as God decides to test Abraham once again. Now, Abraham had already gone through multiple tests where God said to Abraham, get out of the land of your fathers to a place that I will show you. That was a test. When Abraham was in Canaan and there was a great drought and Abraham had to go to Egypt, that was a test. When Abraham was in Egypt with the king, that was a test. Abraham coming back, that was a test. All throughout the course of Abraham's life, he had different tests. And in Genesis, the 22nd chapter, the Bible says that God decided to test Abraham. God purposed in his heart to test Abraham. And he called Abraham, and Abraham replied to God, here I am. And God said, I want you to take your son, your only son. Now, Abraham had another son, Ishmael, but that was not the son of promise. So God says, I want you to take Isaac, the son of promise, your only begotten son. And I want you to take him to the Mount Moriah, and I want you to go to a place that I will show you, and I want you to offer him up as a sacrifice to me. Very hard statement. Oftentimes people get very confused. People get very tense about this section of scripture because how could a God who loves somebody ask for a human sacrifice when we see that in the Bible? That's not what God was going after. And so the Bible tells us that Abraham arose early the next day, and he gathered the firewood, and he gathered all the supplies, and he gathered his servants, and him and his son Isaac and his servants set off on a journey to the place where God showed him. And there Abraham took his son Isaac up onto the mountain. God showed him the place, and there as they were going and they were setting up the altar, God says to Isaac says to Abraham, he says, Dad, I see the rocks for the altar. I see the wood for the altar. I see everything else that we have for the sacrifice, but we don't have a lamb. And Abraham says to Isaac, Isaac, the Lord will provide himself a lamb. Abraham, in his heart, knowing that God had asked and God had required Isaac to be that lamb at that moment. And so there Abraham lies Isaac on the altar and binds him up. And as the Bible says that Abraham, was his hand was in the air with the knife in his hand ready to end his son's life for a sacrifice to God, the angel of the Lord cries out and says, Abraham, stop! And he says these words. He says, now I know that you are faithful. Now I know, Abraham, you have passed the test. Now see, in this section of scripture, God was testing Abraham. Well, you see, we go through tests in life. I remember about a little over 10 years ago, and my wife and I, we were in university together. We were in college. And I've always had an MO in my life. I've always had a certain way that everybody goes through tests differently. And I remember that when we were going through college, I always had this kind of mindset that I know what I know. And if I don't know it, cramming it in the night before a test is not going to help me know it for the test. So, you know, I would always just kind of go through it and just with that mindset. My wife, she was the opposite. She handles tests very differently. And I remember she would always spend nights and weeks and hours cramming all of the information she could into her mind so that the next day for that test, she could do the best she could because she was a very academic student. And I remember she was, at the time we were just dating, we were about to get married soon, and She was so frustrated because she would see me and I'd go home and I was just hanging out and I was doing whatever, just you know, enjoying life at the time, going to bed early or going to bed late, just hanging out with everybody. And there she was at home, locked in a room all by herself, cramming all this information into her mind to try to pass the test. And so I remember it was American history in college. And she said, you know what, I'm so tired of the fact that you do nothing to study and you get good grades. And I work so hard to get the grades that I get. I'm not studying. If I know it, I know it. And if I don't know it, well, I just don't know it. Well, try it out. You know, whatever. So it was the midterm exam. Now, the 50% of her grade was based on this test. So she decided to take my philosophy with testing and try it on her midterm. And I remember we were sitting there in American history and we were taking our midterm exam. And, you know, I knew what I knew and what I didn't know. I always used the good old Adam, eeny, meeny, miny, moe. And it seems like it's always worked out for me pretty well. And so I could see the pressure on her face during that test. And when we got the results back a week later, I did all right on the test. I did pretty decent. I was happy with the results. For the very first time and the only time in her life, she received an F grade, a failing grade on her midterm exam. She was so upset. Never again would she ever come back to a test with that type of a mindset. She went back to cramming for all the other tests that she took. You see, we all go through tests and we all deal through tests differently. You have tests all the time in your life, not just when you were in school. We're talking way after school. I mean, think about it. You had to go to the DMV and take a test to get your driver's license. When you show up at work, oftentimes there are tests, tests to ensure you know the safety rules, tests to ensure you know the requirements of your positions. There are tests all the time in the course of life. But did you know that we also go through spiritual tests in our lives? That we will be tested all throughout the course of our life, spiritually speaking. Like the Bible says here, Abraham, when he was tested, God tested Abraham through the course of his life. You see, your faith will be put to the test. Not just your faith, how about this? Your character. Your character will be put to the test. Your resolve will be put to the test. You see, God, throughout the course of your life, will test you in your life. And that is a very difficult concept for us to grab a hold of. Because we see God as this loving, we see God as this all-caring Father. And so why would he test us? Because tests involve pressure. Tests involve preparation. Tests oftentimes in life, especially spiritual tests, involve pain. And so nobody likes tests. There's only a few crazy people I know in my life that actually like tests. Most everybody else dreads tests. Most everybody thinks, man, can I call in sick today? Do I have to go to class? Do I have to take my DMV test? And all of us, we dread tests. But you see, the Bible gives us some very clear insight in our lives, that we are going to be tested in our spiritual walk with God. It's an integral part of our relationships with God. And not only are we going to be tested, but we are going to be tested by God in our lives. As a matter of fact, the Bible says in Proverbs 17, chapter verse number 3, it says that the refining pot is for silver and for gold, but the Lord tests the hearts. The psalmist, David, as well throughout the Psalms, they say, they cry out to God, God, test my heart, search my heart, reveal on the inside of me what you have. There are going to be times in your life where God is going to test you. And that's a hard thing to grab a hold of, because nobody likes tests. And why would God, who loves us, put us in a position of pressure, of pain, or allow things to happen so that we would face these tests? Because we don't like them. The truth of the matter is whether we like them or not, they're coming. But we don't have to be afraid of tests. We don't have to fear the tests that God puts on our lives, because I believe that when we get a good understanding of tests, and we see a test, and oftentimes we see trials, and oftentimes we see tribulations, and we have this mindset about disliking them and disliking tests. So we kind of get this mindset of, is God in heaven pranking me? Are all the angels laughing at me? Where are the cameras? Are they going to come out of the bushes and be like, gotcha, in this course of our life? But you see, God has a purpose for tests. There's a reason we go through spiritual tests in our lives. The Bible calls them tests. The Bible calls them tribulations. The Bible calls them trials. The Bible calls them temptations. We will endure these things in our lives. And there's something, if I believe that if we can get the right understanding of why we test, because ultimately that's the greatest question we always ask. Whenever there's something going on that's hard in our lives, whenever there's pain, whenever there's trial, whenever there's tribulations, the question we want to ask is, why me, oh God? Why now? Why everything was going good. Why did this have to happen? Why am I going through this? We see somebody over there going through a test, or somebody in our life. God, why are they going through this? How could you let that happen in their lives? And we begin to ask these questions, why test? Why is this happening to me? And I believe that when we can answer that question, when we look at why God tests us, we have a right and a greater understanding of what these tests, these trials, these tribulations, these temptations that come our way really do and really mean for us. And so today I want to look at that, and we'll take some of that and put some application to it as well. The question we always ask is, why test? Well, first we need to understand that the test is not for God. God doesn't need to know the answer to the test, because God already knows the answer to the test. You see, we think in the linear sense, time begins when we're born, and time ends when we die, and everything else is just gray. But so we think, what's tomorrow gonna bring? And what's the next day gonna bring? And we don't know, but you see, the Bible tells us that God is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. God does not work in a linear sense where he does not know what tomorrow brings. He knows everything. He knows the end. He knows the beginning. God does not work and think how we work and we think. Therefore, God already knows the answer to the test. When God called Abraham to offer Isaac, God knew what was going to happen through the course of that test, but Abraham did not yet know. You see, because when God tests us, the answer is not for God to find the answer. God already knows. The answer is for us to find the answer. To realize, to recognize, to look at ourselves and to say, wow, I didn't know this about me, or I didn't see that about me, or to test my faith, to test my character. Did I pass it? Did I fail it? Not always will we pass tests, but we can learn and we can gather. But when we recognize that God's not testing us because he wants to know the answer, he already knows the answer. If you want to try to fry your brain and think about that for a moment, the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ was the Lamb of God slain before the foundations of the earth. I thought he died 2,000 years ago. You see, God does not work in the linear sense. God already knows the answer. The Bible says that God knows you from before you were born. God knew you. So God knows every decision you're going to make. He knows every thought you're going to think. He knows everything that's going to happen in your life. He knows everything and how that's going to affect. He knows everything about you. God knows you better than you know you. And the purpose of a test is for not God to find the answer, but for you and for me to find the answer. Because tests push us to grow. Ultimately, that's the whole purpose of a test. When you're in school and you take a test, it's to ensure that you know what you were taught. When you go to the DMV and you take a test, the reason they're doing that is they want to make sure that you know, because you know this, that the yellow light does not mean speed up. Okay, maybe you didn't know that one. They give you 7 questions to fail. It's all right. But tests are there to ensure that you know, or you've gotten what you're supposed to know, to cause you to grow, to push you into a new area of your life. That's the whole purpose of tests. And ultimately, we would all love to sit on Easy Street, to find a beach somewhere in life and sit back and enjoy the sun and, like water, take the path of least resistance. Can anybody say amen to trials and troubles in the path of least resistance? But you see, in the good times, sitting on the beaches of life, taking the path of least resistance never pushes us to grow. To never pushes us to get out of our comfort zone, to go to somewhere new, to go to places that we had never been before. And that's the purpose of a test. It's not that God needs the answer, that you and I need the answer. And God wants to take us. He wants to push us to grow. In the book of Acts, I won't be up on the overhead, but I'll just tell you about it. Acts, the first chapter, verse number 8, when Jesus is speaking to his disciples, he says, listen, he says, when you receive the Holy Spirit, you will be witnesses of me. You'll be witnesses of me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria. And he says, and all the world. That's so amazing that he tells these fishermen, these tax collectors, these ordinary men, you are going places for me. But you see, the Bible tells us in the book of Acts in the 8th chapter that there was something happened. A young man, the very first martyr for Jesus Christ, Stephen, had just died. And the Bible says that they laid Stephen's clothes at the feet of a young man named Paul, or Saul, who was a persecutor of Christians or followers of Jesus. In verse number 1, the Bible says that Saul was consenting to his death, Stephen's death. And at that time, a great persecution arose against the church. Where? At Jerusalem. You see, Jesus said, you're going to go from Jerusalem, you're going to go to Judea, you're going to go to Samaria, you're going to go to all the world. And undoubtedly, these men were doing that. But God said, listen, I got a plan for the church to grow, and it needs to go a little bit faster than you want it to happen. So all of a sudden, a new character is introduced. His name is Saul, who persecutes the church. And look what it says in the second part of that verse. And they were all scattered. You see, there was a revival going on in Jerusalem. There were thousands of people being added to the church daily, the Bible said. Jerusalem was on fire. But Jesus and God said, listen, Jerusalem can't be the only place. We got to get this out to the world. But they were comfortable in Jerusalem. But look what happened. Verse number 4. Verse number 4 of Acts, the 8th chapter. Look what happened. Therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. Preaching the word. You see, God used a man by the name of Saul to bring persecution on the church, to spread them out. Like a light that gets flipped on and all the cockroaches go, psh, gone. All of a sudden the light shine and everybody jammed out of Jerusalem. And because they did that, the word of God didn't just spread in Jerusalem. Now all of a sudden the word of God that Jesus said, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all the world exploded around the planet. Because God wants us to grow. He does not want you to stay where you are. He doesn't want you to remain where you are. He did not die. He did not send Jesus to die on the cross so that you could just stay the way you are. He sent Jesus on the cross to give you a new life, an abundant life, and he wants to take you to the next level. Tests are designed to take you to the next level in life. You see, you might have a dream. The Bible says that God is a God who is exceedingly above all that we could ask or think. You might have a big dream, but God says, I've got an even bigger dream for you. I've got an even bigger purpose for you. I've got a reason for you to live, and I want to take you to it. And tests are designed to take us to to the next level. I remember in 1985, Nintendo came out with Super Mario Brothers. I mean, revolutionized entertainment as we know it. I mean, 16-bit graphics, color, controllers, and not a joke. I mean, it was insane. And there was this time in Super Mario Brothers where Mario or whoever the character was, you had to go and you had to play through a level. And at the end of that level, there was always a boss, a villain, whoever it was. And Mario or whoever the character was had to jump on the boss's head or throw turtle shells at him or fireballs or whatever Mario had at him. And the boss was the challenge. It was the test for that level because you see, right after that boss was the next level in the game. And that next level in the game was harder. And if you couldn't beat the boss at the current level, you would not be able to pass the next level. You see, tests are so much like that. God has another level for you. God wants to take you from where you're at to the next level. And the tests in life are exactly that formation, that period of our life where we begin to develop, because the next level is going to bring a whole new set of issues. But God says, you're going to have to stomp on the devil's head a little bit. You're going to have to go through some trials. You're going to have some hard times and some tests in your life. But when you come out of it, you'll be stronger. You'll be wiser. You'll be bigger. You'll have a bigger capacity in life because God wants to take you to the next level in life. In the book of James, in the first chapter, sometimes the Bible has those verses that you just don't like reading. You know what I'm talking about? Like, man, can I just skip that one? James, in the first chapter, we were here a couple of weeks ago. The Bible says, James says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Because look at verse number 2. It says, knowing that the what? Testing of your faith produces patience. The testing of your faith produces patience. Why? Because a test is not for God. It's for you to know the answer. A test is purposed to cause you to grow because God wants to take you to another level. And so the testing of your faith, the testing of your life produces patience. But I love what he says in verse number 4. He says, and let patience have its perfect work that you may be perfect and complete and lacking nothing in life. God wants to take you higher, church. That's cause to rejoice. And therefore, that's why James says, when you have a hard time, rejoice. But it wasn't just James. Paul in Romans, the 5th chapter, says, hey, we have rejoicing in trials because of the hope that was shed abroad on the inside of us. Peter says, listen, even though you've been tested right now, you can glory in the revelation of Jesus Christ. We don't have to be down and out during trials because God wants to take you to another level. God wants to take you to another level. You see, tests are designed to cause us to grow. God wants to take you to another level. But listen to this. Tests are designed to take you to another level, but never to bring you down. Oftentimes what happens in the pain, in the trials, in the tribulations, and in the temptations, we feel like God's picking on me. Why is he doing this to me? My business was going good. My kids were doing great. My family was, everything was good. And now all of a sudden I'm on this downward slope. And I feel like God is just out to get me. But you see, God will never violate his character to test you. God will never violate his character ever. God is consistent, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Which means that if Jesus Christ died to save you from sin, God will not make you sin. If Jesus Christ died to save you from sickness, God will not make you sick. We were just there in James, the first chapter. James, the first chapter, verse number 13, says, let no one say, when they are tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. You see, the purpose of a test is to bring you higher, not take you lower. God is not going to do anything in his character that would violate his character to test you. Which means that God might not tempt you, but he will allow you to be tempted. God won't tempt you, but he will allow you to be tempted. Listen, you got to understand this. We got to have a right understanding of the Word of God, and we got to have a right understanding of tests. God will not violate his character to test you, which means God did not kill your family member to put you through a test. God will not tempt you to sin. God did not give you cancer or some type of illness to put you through a test. Why? Because the Bible says that Jesus Christ died that we might have life. Therefore, God would not do anything to violate that character. The Bible says that Jesus Christ died to save us from the bondages of sin. Therefore, God would not do anything to violate that promise. The Bible says that by His stripes we are healed. Therefore, God would not do anything to violate that character. God did not make you sick. God did not kill your family member. God did not discipline somebody else to test you, but He sees it and He allows it. And that's hard. That's hard because we get this judgment, we get this righteousness in our head. God, why would you let that happen? That was a good person. God, why would this go on? Why all the different things that are going on in the world? Why would you allow that to happen? Because God is a God of opportunity. And while God won't tempt you, while God won't make you sick, while God won't kill or discipline a family member on your behalf to test you, He will take the opportunity that is used to turn it around to take you to the next level. Through that sickness, God will say, hey, listen, I got some things I want to show you. Things that you didn't know you were capable of. Things that you didn't even know that were coming your way. I want to show you something good about that. Through that trial, through that tribulation, through that hard time, God says, I'm going to take that and I'm going to turn around. And the Bible says what the devil meant for, like Joseph said, what the devil meant for bad, what you meant for bad, God has turned it around for good. God is always a God of opportunity. See, God won't tempt you, but He will allow it. The book of Job, a crazy, crazy, crazy story. You think you got hardships? Read Job, okay? Bible tells us in the first chapter, kind of a weird story, you know, kind of a weird conversation. Everybody came to God, and the devil came to God, and God's like, hey, what you been doing, devil? And he's like, oh, you know, I've been walking to and fro on the earth, seeing who I can punk. God's like, have you considered Job? I'm like, wait a minute, you're kind of sending him a recommendation? Yeah, have you considered Job? He's forthright, and he's upright with me, he's a good man, he's a righteous man. The devil's like, you know what, I bet you I can get Job to curse your name. Bible tells us in Job, the first chapter, verse number 12, God says to Satan, behold, all that Job has is in your power. Just do not lay a hand on him. What? Why would God do that? Oh, I get it, because that's Old Testament. All of a sudden a switch got flipped and it was like a different God, right? No, it's in the New Testament as well. Did you know that in Luke, the 22nd chapter, Jesus says to Peter, Simon, behold, Satan has asked for you. That he might sit for you. Satan asked for you. But oh, I love the next verse. Number 32. Doesn't you love? Look what it says. Jesus says, I have prayed for you.
Oh, hallelujah.
Don't you know when Jesus prays, something gets done? Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says that he continually makes intercession for us. He says, Peter, Satan's asked for you, but I've prayed for you. But did you notice look what he prayed. That your faith should not fail. He didn't say, Peter, Satan asked for you, and I prayed, and I said no. He said, I prayed that your faith would not fail. And when you have returned, when you get punked by the devil, strengthen your brother. Strengthen your brethren. You see, this is in context, this is the statement when Jesus tells Peter, you're going to deny me. Peter says, absolutely, I'm not denying you. Peter says, Satan asked for you by name, bro. And I didn't tell him no. But when you go through that, strengthen your brethren. Okay, but that's, you know, okay, let's just do another one. All right, Matthew, the fourth chapter. Bible says that Jesus himself was led into the wilderness by the Spirit of God. By the Spirit of God, which means Jesus didn't just kind of like trip and fall and find himself in the wilderness. He was led into the wilderness by the Spirit of God. Why? To be tested by the devil. He got the general. You need to understand this. The devil's not omnipotent. God is omnipotent. God is everywhere all at once. The devil is not. So when you get tempted, when you get tested, when you get a trial, you get one of his little henchmen to do his job for you. Jesus got the general. And he got through it. You see, because God won't violate his character, but he will allow it. Why? Because on the tail end of this, Job, after all of the trials that Job went through, his life was so much better at the end of that trial. He had more than he ever began with. His family was restored. His life was restored. Everything that the devil took away, God gave him an increase. Peter went from being a denier of Jesus to a declarer of Jesus, who came and apostled and founded and built upon the church. The words that Jesus said, upon this rock, I will build my church. Now Peter was that man. Jesus went up into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, to be tested by the general himself of evil. And yet, the moment he comes down from that altar, or from that mountain, he calls himself disciples. He calls to himself disciples, and he begins his ministry just right there. Because you see, on the tail end of that, God's got something for you. He's going to take that opportunity, that hardship, that trial, that tribulation, that temptation, while it may not be from God himself, he will take it and he will turn it around and he will show you what you need to know in that question so that you can go to the next level. God wants to take you there. And the beautiful thing about this is, as hard as that might be to get, the beautiful thing about this is that God knows you. God knows you better than you know you. Did you know that? You see, you think you know you. Pastor Luke, ain't nobody know me like me. Because I know my thoughts. I know I'm... You don't know what tomorrow is.
That's right.
But God does.
Yes.
You don't know the thoughts you're going to think tomorrow. But God already knows.
Yeah.
You see, God knows you better than you know you. That's why he says, I knew you before you were even created. And because God knows you, he's not going to put on your plate. He's not going to test you with more than you can endure. God will never or only allow what you can endure. Which means he's not going to break you. He's not here to crush you. He's not here to stomp you into the ground and laugh at you like a little kid sitting on an anthill, crushing little helpless ants. God is here to build you up. To bring you to the next level. To do something in your life and to turn situations of trials and hardships and temptations, to turn those into opportunities to reveal things about you that you never knew, but God always did. God will never give you more than you can endure. I remember there was this movie a couple of years ago called Facing the Giants, about a football coach who decided that everything he would do it to God. He would praise God in it. And I remember there was a football team and they weren't doing too well, and there was a couple players that were pretty weak in that, and they had to do this thing called a death crawl. A death crawl is where you walk on your hands and on your feet without your knees or any other part of your body. You crawl, basically crab crawl, across the football field carrying the weight of another player on your back. And this player, he couldn't do it, he couldn't handle it, and the coach knew that there was something better in there, and so he blindfolds this player and tells him, okay, I want you to death crawl across this football field. And there he begins to start, and he's crying, and you can see his muscles are shaking, and he's shaking under the pressure of this death crawl. And then about a couple minutes into this crawl, he starts to cry out, he starts to shout out, I can't do it! And the coach says, yes you can, push, push! Push, and he's like, I can't, and he's keep doing it, and he's shaking, and I can't do it, and finally he collapses onto the ground, and he drops the player on his back, but because he was blindfolded, he didn't know where he was, and the coach said, take off your blindfold. As he took off his blindfold, he realized that he was in the end zone on the other side of the football field. So you see, he had the capability to do it all along, he just never thought he could. So you might be going through a trial, you might be going through a tribulation, you might be going through a hardship where you think, there is no way I can make it through this. But God knows you better than you know you. And God will never give to you, and God will never put upon you in a test more than you can handle. The Bible says that a bruised reed he will not break. And in the book of 1 Corinthians, in the 10th chapter, the Bible tells us that no temptation has overtaken us except which is common to man. Thank God you're not alone, but Pastor Luke, you don't know the troubles I've been. Somebody else has been there. He says, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. God knows you. You can make it. You can do it. You can get through this hardship. You can get through this trial. You can get through this tribulation. When God told Abraham about Isaac, God knew that Abraham could make it through the hardest challenge he'd ever have to face in his life. Even if Abraham didn't know it, God did. Because God will never give you more than you can handle in your test and in your trial. So we have an understanding of tests. We have an understanding of trials. There's a principle, a leadership principle called know and do. The army applies it, and the be, know, and do. Be the position that you are. You got to be what we told you to be. You got to know. You got to get the knowledge. And you got to do what you know. It's very simple. Know and do. Today I want to take you, and I wanted to show you some things. And we've talked about understanding and enlightening as to why God tests us. But now I want to tell you, if anything else today you remember, if anything else you take home with you today, this is what I want you to take with you today, and this is the know. To know this, that every test has an answer. Jesus. Every test you go through in life that's spiritual, every pain, every trial, every tribulation, every temptation, every test you go through, spiritually speaking, has an answer: Jesus. 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 You see, because Jesus is everything, he's the only thing. If the answer is Oprah, then it's going to change. If the answer is Dr. Phil or the latest sociologist to say this or the latest psychology, if the answer is this new diet, they're going to come out in a couple of months and say, that's not the right one to be on. It's this one. And it will always change. But you see, the Bible tells us that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He does not change. And because he does not change, he allows us to. But the trials that you face, there is an answer. It may not seem logical. It may not be apparent. It may not be visible. But the answer is there, and the answer is Jesus. We were just there in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Look what it says in the second half of that verse, verse number 13. He says, but God with temptation will also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. That way of escape is Jesus. You see, in Genesis, the 22nd chapter, when Isaac says to his dad, I see the fire and I see the wood and I see everything to make a sacrifice except for the lamb, Abraham says, God will provide. We live in a new time. We live in a new period. We live in a new season where Abraham had to say, God will provide. You and I, we get to say, God has provided. Jesus has died. Jesus has come, which means the answer has been given to you. The answer to sickness, Jesus. The answer to fulfillment, Jesus. The answer to faith questioned, Jesus. Jesus is everything. Jesus is the only thing. If anything, when you walk out of this place today, know that you're going to go through a trial. But every trial, every test has an answer. And that answer is Jesus. Yeah. That's the know. You got to know that. Okay? Now the do. What do? Well, you do what you know. What do? What you know? You do this. You fix your eyes and your heart on Jesus. That's the do. You see, the devil, he's not going to take you going to another level laying down. He's not going to take you advancing in the kingdom of God laying down. He's going to do everything he can to throw at you that God is doing this to you, to convince you and to sway you that you are all by yourself in this trial, to convince you of the thought that there is no hope, there is no answer, and there is no solution, so that you would walk away despaired and discouraged. Because Jesus said the thief doesn't come but to steal, to kill, and destroy. That's his mission in life, is to destroy humanity, because God said, let us make them in our image. So you see, the devil's going to fight and convince you and work to convince you. But how do we not give into that? By keeping our eyes and keeping our heart fixed and focused upon Jesus, because Jesus Christ is the answer. And that same story as Abraham's hand was in the air and the angel cries out to Abraham, Abraham, stop! The Bible says Abraham did something very important. It says that he lifted his eyes. And when he lifted his eyes, all of a sudden, he saw there was a ram over in the distance, caught in a bush by its horns. God had provided. You see, the answer was always there. He just hadn't seen it yet. People say, I have such a hard time believing that God would ask for a human sacrifice. God never asked for a human sacrifice. God asked Abraham, are you willing to endure the pain so that I can take you to the next level that I want to take you? And the answer was always there. Abraham just didn't see it. See, we've got to fix our eyes on Jesus, our answer. Because we'll look to the left and we'll look to the right. We'll look to this person for that answer, for this person for that answer. We'll look to ourselves. But we have to look at Jesus, the answer, the solution. You see, when we fix our eyes on Jesus, we're focusing on the solution and not the problem. Amen. It's so easy to focus on the problem. I remember when I was young, I had a knife that was way too sharp. Thanks, Mom and Dad. Just kidding. And I was carving something. And as soon as I carved, I went right into my hand. It went right down into the bone. You know, when you go through pain, when you go through pressure, if you've ever hurt yourself or if you've ever had something happen to you that was very painful, you know, the very first thing you do is you go like this. Yes. Focus on the pain. Everything else goes black. Everything else goes blurry. The only thing you can see is the pain, because your mission is to get rid of it. So when we're in tests, we focus on the pain. We focus on the problems. We focus on the people that are creating problems in our life. But God says, listen, I don't want you to focus on the pain. I don't want you to focus on the problems. I have given to you an answer, and his name is Jesus. And I want you to not look at the problem. I want you to look at the answer. Focus on the answer, Jesus. The book of Hebrews tells us. Remember how the Bible says that the Spirit of God led Jesus into the wilderness? Because of this reason, Hebrews 11, our fourth chapter, says that Jesus, who is our high priest, we don't have a high priest that doesn't sympathize. Jesus knows what you're going through. He knows what betrayal is. He knows what temptation is. He knows what hardships are. He knows what you're going through. But the Bible says that he was tempted as we are, tested like us, but yet without sin. And because of that, verse number 16, we can go to the throne of grace to obtain mercy and find grace and help in a time of need. Jesus is everything, church. He's the only thing. And our eyes fixed on him focuses on that solution and not on that problem. Our hearts aligned to Jesus keep them open for God to work. You see, because as we focus in on our pain, we focus in, everything else goes around us, and our hearts have a tendency to want to harden, because we cry out, God, why? God, why now? Why me? Why them? How could you let this happen? How could you allow that over there? God, I don't understand it. God, I'm mad at you for it. And our hearts begin to close so that we don't hear what God wants to show us, because the answer was never for God. It was always for us. And we miss out on the voice of God, and we miss out on the leading of God that says, I want to take you to another level. And we begin to fail that test. But you see, focusing on Jesus, worshiping after God, saying, God, it doesn't, despite how I feel, even though my life might be crashing around me, even though, like, there's a song that says, even though it hurts like hell, I'll praise you. When we focus on Jesus, everything else begins to disappear, including the pain and the trials, and now our hearts remain open for God to begin to do surgery in our lives. See, a couple of months ago, I'm in a trial right now. I'm in a test right now, and it sucks. Can I say that? All right. A couple of months ago, I didn't, you know, you don't realize what you look like. You ever been there? Everybody else sees it, but you? A couple of months ago, my mom could see where I was at, Pastor Deborah, and she says, listen, I got a book. I need you to read this book. It's a book that I grew up, I'm convinced this book was like my second grade nighttime reading. They read this to me at night when to go to bed. I had grown up with this book. I was familiar with the message of the book, and she could see what was going on in my heart, and she could see what was going on. She says, you need to read that book. I've read it, Mom. I've heard it. I've read it through you. A couple months later goes by. 3 months later goes by. She says, man, I can see it on you. You need to read this book. Change my life and it'll change your life. I didn't read the book. All of a sudden, boom, I enter into a pressure cooker, into a test. Now I'm going through it. And all of a sudden, I look over the book on my nightstand and I say, I'm gonna start reading that book. Chapter 1, page 2, nails my flesh to the cross. You see, perhaps I missed out on the opportunity by 6 months ago not reading that book, but I believe that God knew where I was going. And God knew that in this trial, if I focus in on him, my heart is open. And instead of crying out, why God? Why? How? What did I do? Like Abraham, I cry out, here I am. Here I am. And now all of a sudden, God can say, I've got the answers. And I'm going to take you somewhere. And this is going to be hard. And you're going to struggle. And you're going to feel this way. And you're going to do this. And you're going to hear these thoughts. And people are going to say these things. But I'm going to take you to another level because of this test. And my heart was open to receive and to hear what God wanted to speak into my life. You see, Abraham responded, here I am. And God blessed him. Job did not curse God. Job had his complaints, but when God spoke, Job listened because his heart was open to God. Peter, his heart was open to Jesus when Jesus said, do you love me? Feed my sheep. His heart was open in that test. Jesus, his heart was open, and everybody who went through a test and passed it, you see, the greater the test, the greater the reward. God wants to take you to a new level. And like the children of Israel, the Bible says they were tested over and over again by God, but their hearts were hardened to his word. They walked and they wandered the wilderness for 40 years in the desert until the generation who had an open heart was ready to receive God's promises. By fixing our eyes on Jesus Christ, by focusing on Jesus as our solution and not looking at our problems, and by focusing our heart, it keeps it open so that God can say, you're in a trial. Child, I know that you're struggling. I know that you don't think that there's an answer, but I need you to know there is an answer, and Jesus is that answer. And if you focus on him, he's going to speak to you. He's going to work in you. He's going to do something great in you, and he's going to take that trial. He's going to take that pain, and he's going to turn it around, and he's going to make you better, stronger, bigger, and greater for his glory. Because you can make it. It might feel like you can't make it, but God knows you better than you. And you might say, God, you don't understand. I can't make it. But all along, Jesus is there, your coach, the captain of your salvation, on his knees right next to you saying, keep going, keep going, keep pushing, keep going, keep going. I got an answer for you. You can make it because every test has an answer. Jesus. Church, he's everything. He's the only thing that matters to us in life. And when we focus on him, when we do what we know, we fix our eyes on him, we look at the problem, or we look at the solution, not the problem. Our hearts are open to allow God to speak to us, to use that trial, to use that test, to use that hardship to say, I got something for you, and you don't even know where you're going, but I can't wait to see you get there. Because Abraham, Isaac was Abraham's greatest test, but it was Abraham's greatest promise. And you see, when you make it through it, God's gonna take you to another level. If you don't make it through the test, I've failed so many tests in my life. But I keep my heart open. God will say, listen, you didn't do good on that one, but now you know. And do what you know. You failed that character test, now you do what you know. Failed that faith test, all right, now you do what you know. Because I'm going to take you to another level, God says. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Yeah. Listen, before we leave today, I don't want to leave under assumptions and pretenses. And so I just want to take a couple quick moments. I don't want to take much more of your time, so just give me a couple moments, okay? Don't get up, don't leave. Just listen to what I got to say. I don't want to leave under the pretenses, under the assumption that everybody in here is okay and everybody's right with God. The Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. So I just want to ask you, are you okay with God? Think about that question for a moment. Where are you at with God? You know, so often we think that if I'm okay with God, or, you know, I hope I'm all right with God, that's going to be good enough. That's going to suffice God's requirements for us. Oftentimes we think, well, you know what? I go to church, and people who go to church are good with God, so I'm good. You know, I'm a Christian. I'm not a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Muslim or anything like that. I when the census came knocking on my door, I checked Christian on my box. Christians are good with God. I'm a good person. I do good things. I give to charitable organizations, and I try to help out my fellow human being, and good people are okay with God. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can think that you're okay with God and that makes it good enough? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a member of a church, because you attend church, because you hear the pastor preach, because you come on Christmas and on Easter, because you got a gold star attendance record. Did you know that nowhere in God's word does it say that that makes you good with him? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself a title, well, I'm a Christian. I thought that that's what it meant. Nowhere in the Bible does it, because you call yourself a Christian, mean that you're good with God. Well, but I'm a good person. Did you know that nowhere in God's word does it say that your good works are what make you good with God? The Bible says that your good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. You see, there's a standard that God has to be good. The problem is that we have all missed that standard. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, which means nothing that you do on your own, no matter how you think, no matter how hard you try, no matter what you do to find the answers, you'll never be good with God except for God's way. Why? Because Jesus Christ, like we talked about today, is the answer. You see, Jesus is everything. Jesus is the only thing and the only way that you and I find ourselves in a good, in a right position with God, a position that finds us in eternal destiny in heaven with God. Skipping out on hell. Ah, Pastor Luke, I don't like that word. I don't like that thought. Listen, whether you like it or not, the Bible says that it's appointed for man to die and face judgment. There's two options, heaven or hell. It's in the Word of God. I didn't come up with it. It's real enough for God to teach his people about it in the Bible, real enough for Jesus Christ himself to tell us about it, real enough for you and I to take it serious. But you see, God's destiny for you was never hell, was never rejection, was never assumption to be good. God's destiny for you was always to be right and in good standing with him, to spend eternity with him in paradise. So much so that he gave his most valuable possession, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross so that every person on earth who sinned and was short of the glory of God, now Jesus became the gap that stood in the chasm so that we can now be reunited and connected with God, and now we could be right with God, and we could know that our life and eternity is with him in heaven. See, it only comes through Jesus, because the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one goes to the Father except through him. It doesn't matter that somebody blew water over you or sprinkled water over you as a baby. You can't find that in the Bible. It doesn't matter that you've given yourself a title. You don't see that in the Bible. It doesn't matter that you're a good person. You don't even see that in the Bible. What matters is Jesus. Jesus is the door, he says. He's the gate. He's the way. And today I want to give you the opportunity to ensure your position with God is right and whole. That you don't have to walk out of this place wondering and hoping and afraid of what tomorrow might have, but you might look forward because you know that with Jesus, your destiny and your future is always bright. Today I want to give you that opportunity. You see, the Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation. And like any gift you get, when somebody gives you a birthday gift or a Christmas gift, you have a choice. You can accept that gift or you can return it or reject that gift. You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. Some people like to say, well, if God wants me, he'll take me. God did everything he could by giving Jesus to die on a cross for our sin and our shame that we could be reconnected with God. So often we think, well, you know, there's so many religions around the world, so many belief systems that they believe in a God and believe in the same things that Christians believe in a sense, but what makes Christianity any different? Why? Because Jesus is the only one that died for your sins, who was perfect, created by God, as a human, brought here as a human, God incarnate, to die for your sins. That's why Jesus is the only answer. He's everything. He's the only thing. Today I want to give you that opportunity. In the book of John, Jesus is speaking to a religious man, and he says, you know, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. Born again, what does that mean? Born again means that you are no longer you, who you think you are now. You are who God says you are. You are a new creation, the Bible says, because of Jesus Christ. Walking away from yourself and walking to God. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. It's not what Hollywood or society's made it out to be. It's an all or nothing relationship with God through his son, Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking himself to the churches, and he says, listen, I know your works, I know your deeds, I know you. He says, I'd rather find that you're hot, I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because right now you're lukewarm, and if I find you lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you, I'll reject you from the kingdom of God. What does that mean, lukewarm? Lukewarm is stagnant, it's still, it serves no purpose. It's not one thing or the other, it's in the middle. And Jesus says, listen, I didn't die on a cross for your sin and your shame so that you could be exactly the same way tomorrow as you are today. He says, I died to give you life, that you might have it abundantly in this world and in heaven. You see, in return, God wants all of our heart. He wants all of our life. Lukewarm, it's just a little bit up and a little bit down. Occasional church attendance. You know, you're really good at doing the Sunday thing when you're here, but then on Monday through Saturday, you're kind of doing your own thing. You know the game. Listen to that. Don't let that be you. That's not God's plan. That's not God's desire for you. God has something better in store for you, and it starts by accepting Jesus into your heart and into your life. Listen, you know, you've lived your life. You know that no matter how much money you have, know how many friends you have, no matter what title they give you, there's always an emptiness on the inside of us, because there was an emptiness created on the inside of us that could be only filled by God, because Jesus is the answer to our life, the answer to your fulfillment, the answer to your happiness, the answer to your destiny, the answer to everything in your life, Jesus. And it comes by accepting him as your Lord and as your Savior, as the leader of your life. You see, Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you. He says, but if you deny him, he will deny you. Today, I want to give you the opportunity, and I want to do it God's way today. And I'm going to do something. I'll count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And what I do, I'm asking you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what? I want to make a decision today. I want to decide today to follow Jesus. I'm going to decide. I'm going to give my heart, and I'm going to give my life to Jesus Christ today. I've been running from him. I've been doing my own thing. I'm tired of the way things are, and I want to go towards Jesus today. I'm making a decision. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. Who should raise their hands in this place? If you've never given Jesus your heart, never given him your life, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group, but you never really followed through with it. Maybe you went to a great crusade and you prayed a prayer, but you've just never really felt that difference in your life. Listen, today I want to ensure you, I want to encourage you today to make that decision and let's follow through together. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own things, if you've been running from God instead of to God, listen, today, this is the day of your salvation. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. Now it's a divine appointment. You're here today for this very reason. Because God has a purpose and God has a destiny for you, and it starts by accepting that call into your life. The Bible says that it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It's not me, it's not the person next to you, it's God speaking to you right now. And if you look into your heart, you look into your soul right now, you know where you are with God. And today it's the time for you, it's the day of your salvation, the day for you to respond to the invitation of God in your life. And we're gonna do that right now. I'm gonna count to three, and when I do, pop your hand up. From the front row to the back row, from the side to side, even you guys in the family rooms, I see you through the windows. Maybe you're watching on the television around the campus through the closed circuit television, or you're at home or abroad with the live stream, wherever you're at. If you're on the live stream, you can minimize your browser. There's a blue button that says "No God" with a question mark. Click on that and you'll be led into prayer. Today, if that's you in this place, this is the moment of your salvation, the day your life will change forever, and it starts by making that decision to follow Jesus. So when I count to three, if that's you in this place, I want you to pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge you. Put it right back down, and we'll follow through together right after that. But it starts by making that decision. So I'm going to count to three. When I do, if that's you, this is your moment. This is your time. Don't wait another moment. Today is the day. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three. I see you guys right over there. Three wise people. Four. I got you right over there, my man. Four wise people. Anybody else? Where you at? Hands in this place. Five. I got you right over here. Five wise people. Say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. Where are you at? Six, I see you in the family rooms right over there. I know that there's more than six. If I didn't see you, just give me a little wave so I can catch you. Seven, I got you back there. Eight, I got you back there. Eight wise people, you wondering if that's me. I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. If you're wondering, you should. Be sure today. Anybody else in this place today? Eight wise people. Where are you at, number nine? Where are you at, number 10? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. This is your moment. This is your time. Anybody else today? Well, let's praise God for eight wise people. That's great. Here's what we're going to do. All eight of you that raised your hands, maybe you're number nine, maybe you're number 10, and all the way up to number 15, and you said, man, I should have done this. I just don't know if I could have done that. Listen, it's not too late. You're making a decision, but you know this and I know this. Every decision you make requires action. Otherwise, nothing happens. So doing nothing with this is nothing's going to happen. Now we're going to act on it. We're going to follow through together. We're going to change destinies right here. So for those of you that raise your hand, maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you know it's you. You know it's you because God's speaking to you right now. Here's what we're going to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand up. Elijah's going to sing a song, and I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Grab the person sitting next to you, or look at the person sitting next to you and say, you know, come on, I'll go with you. And get out of your seat, get into the aisle, and come meet me here at this altar right here, because we're going to change destinies together right now. So let's all stand. Please don't leave right now as they come. That discourages them. But if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on, this is your moment. This is your time. Come on. All over this place, if that's you, you come. This is your moment. Come on, this is your time. Well, praise God. You guys came. You guys came. And somebody just needs to tell you, I don't know if you've ever had anybody even tell you this, but somebody needs to tell you, you're doing a good job. You're making the best decision you possibly can. To encourage you to say, hey, well, you know what? Keep going. Not going to a funeral. Going to a birthday celebration. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. God's got something great in store for you. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really cool guy, okay? He's going to do a couple things. He's going to take you guys right over there, but nothing weird goes on. I promise, all right? You got my word. Nothing weird goes on. He's going to do. I'll tell you what he's going to do. He's going to lead you in a prayer, okay? You don't get saved because you raise your hand. You get saved because you're inviting Jesus into your life, okay? So you're going to invite Jesus in your life through a prayer. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some information. We want to we want you to leave this place hooked up, okay? We're going to set you on the right path, real easy to read literature to say, what do I do now that I got saved? We're going to point you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to give away a friend. We're going to give you a friend, okay? Somebody that will meet with you here at church. They'll buy you a cup of coffee, sit down with you, get you a soda if you want something like that before a church service or right after a church service, and teach you some things about the Word of God for just a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big, long program. You're just meeting with somebody to help you build you up in the courage, in the ways of God, so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has. So if you guys would just turn to your left and my right, go right over there to Pastor Joel. Congratulations, guys. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.